Hello and greetings from Iceland, but it's been a while since my last update, or when I was announcing the death of a volcano, and after that I took a short break from YouTube due to how lame this eruption turned out to be. So I used the chance to drive around Iceland with my camera and my drone, of course, using the chance to capture some of the last summer colors for my upcoming projects. But I could read through the comments in my last video that I should have mentioned what we can do for the disappointed tourists who had just arrived or were on the way to Iceland when the eruption faded out. But I have some good tips by the end of this video, which is more or less about the overall situation on the Reykjanes Peninsula, like will there be another eruption and when? So let's start that journey with this earthquake map covering the first weeks after the eruption came to an end. And we are still very far away from any kind of norm. First of all, I want to mention that there are still earthquakes in the dike that fed the eruption. Nothing drastic like before the eruption, but obviously something moving down there. And it would not surprise me if the eruption would start again, although I had a feeling that it might take some time. But then, we are just seeing the start of a 200-year cycle, so volcano tourists will get plenty of opportunities in the future. But let's go a bit deeper into this earthquake map. And keep in mind that the eruption in August came from only one of the three magma intrusions detected this year. But the first magma intrusion occurred just north of this town, Grindavík. And for a while, things got so serious that evacuation plans were made, but I haven't heard so much about the status there now. Like, has the land subsided? And what about the plumbing under there? What do the experts know about it? And how does that magma intrusion fit into the bigger picture? But the only trend I notice now is this lineup beside this old row of craters. But we have seen earthquakes there before, actually. But this time, the swarm continues all the way down to the sea, or through the place where the magnitude 5.5 earthquake struck a little over a month ago. And that earthquake was triggered by changes in tension in the ground due to the magma dike while it was forming. And such earthquakes occurred also here, or in the so-called Grindavík volcanic system. And that location might be the biggest question we face, because we have seen earthquakes there, and quite many of them, for months now. And during the weeks before the eruption, all earthquakes in the region that were a bit off as for location were explained as triggered by tension changes. And it's quite easy to look them up back in time online. And through that tool that I'm linking to, we can see that the earthquakes in this region started well before the magma intrusion started to shake the ground and still go on. So, is there something more going on there than we know about? Because this is a well-known home of many fissures and craters. So, I was there just a few weeks ago, since this is one of my favorite places on the peninsula. The nature is very colorful and full of strange formations wherever we look. And the reason why I'm mentioning this now is because the Grindavík system is a separate system, as our experts define the six systems on the peninsula, and we see here. And I would have placed my bet on the Grindavík system to be the first one to wake up in this cycle, for the simple reason that the ground there has been shaking for years. And what makes the Grindavík system stand out is the fact that its fissure swarm stretches all the way into our capital. And when I zoom into this location, just above the city, we see those huge rift valleys, or not ideal building land, I must say. And one of our experts mentioned the other day that during this cycle we just entered, we might just as well get an eruption around here by the city, or in the next system to the east, a bit further up in the mountains, or where I shot this a while ago with the city in the background. So I think you understand it now why we were so glad to get the eruption in August in the middle of nowhere. This says it all. And those shots are from a video that I have in the making covering the volcanoes around the city, or one of my projects for the winter that required a lot of footage. that I almost have now. But let's move west now, to the westernmost part of the peninsula. And as for earthquakes, the situation is pretty much like it was before the eruption, or unusual unrest all around. But it's widespread now, and the worst case scenario might be an undersea eruption around here, or just around the place where the plate boundaries arise up from the seabed. On average, we get eruptions there every 100 years or so. Islands have been coming and going, and our experts have always said that when one of our systems on the peninsula will wake up, the other systems will follow. And that is exactly what has been happening. Those four systems on the westernmost part of the peninsula have all been showing signs of unrest. So what system is next? And it's simply very hard to say. And when we move a bit further east, we have two systems there that have been relatively quiet. But we need to keep in mind that this system that we often call the Sulphur Mountain system is more or less ready for a magnitude 6 plus earthquake that hits us every 50 years or so. But I have covered that in older videos. And to the west from that we have the Hengill volcanic system. It's categorized as one of the systems on the Reykjanes Peninsula. And it's the only system that has a central volcano. We do get some earthquake swarms there every now and then. But nothing out of the ordinary though, the last 2 years. So it's those four systems that I have been focusing on. And my guess is that the next eruption is not very far away. My guess would be months rather than years. And if it would turn out to be weeks, it would not surprise me. But I have to say that we do not see any such signs now. But I have to admit that the magma intrusion just by Grindavík, it worries me still. But the Krýsuvík system might be even worse scenario, way more serious, because lava from there has and could again flow through the city. And not all are aware of that fact that the capital of Iceland is partially built on old lava fields. So even though we had some good times while the first pages of this new book about the geology of Iceland was written by Mother Nature, we have to keep in mind that there will be some disaster chapters, and what we have seen so far was just a short intro. So as often before, the questions are just piling up, like how bad is the location of the capital of Iceland, Reykjavík? And how much will this active period, perhaps 200 years, change for us? And is it possible that we might have to abandon a part of the metropolitan area, even permanently? And if so, where could we rebuild? And those questions will be a part of my channel's theme for the next months. And I will of course continue to do my updates when I find a good reason to do so. And I suspect that it's only gonna be a matter of days when I have something new for you. Not necessarily from the Reykjanes Peninsula though. And until then, I have a good tourist tip for our disappointed guests. Or what can replace a volcanic eruption? In fact, it's not much, but I can however tell you that the Northern Lights season just started, and it starts strong this year, which is great news because last year was not good, and there are not many words that can describe the feeling to be under this. But this was my first aurora time-lapse, shot just a few days ago on my way back from a photo tour, and this is most likely the only natural phenomena that can ease the pain for disappointed volcano tourists. And I have other good news. The Northern Light forecast looks great now, especially for Sunday evening and Monday. So I'm linking to a rather long video I made last year with my top 10 tips for aurora hunters. And I advise you to take a look at it. And I want also to remind you that it's the first half of the season that's usually better. And the weather helps as well. And a good Northern Light show is an experience that you can enjoy for a lifetime. But of course, there are many levels of strength when it comes to the lights. And some of the images out there are of course over-photoshopped. So I have a video about that online as well. Or what should we expect? But as a local who grew up under the Northern Lights, let me assure you that the best shows are just as spectacular as the best images. So that is my best advice for travelers in Iceland now. The Northern Light forecast is good. I'm linking to it, but it's not perfect though. I see this tendency that they are often later than predicted. So the strongest show might be on a Monday, But I don't care. The forecast is so good that I'm going out, hopefully bringing back around 1,000 frames for a time lapse. And I hope that you, who came here for the volcano, can use this chance as well. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the volcano island, Iceland.